In this video, we will be taking a look at number revision maths. Now, this is aimed at predominantly for the foundation tier for all UK exam boards and international exam boards for GCSE 9-1 maths. And it's also appropriate for Key Stage 3 maths, okay? And potentially for higher tier students as well, as like a form of revision. So we will start with place value. This is question number one. Write the number 4021 in words. Well, in words is FOURTHOUSAND. So 4,000 and is A and D. 20, so TW. So 20, 1, and then it's ONE. Okay. So that's writing that figure and that number in words. Okay, this is question number two. Write the number 72,308 in words. Well, it's 70. So, 7, SEVENTY. So, 72,000. TW0 for the number 2. 1,000 is THOUSAND. THREE HUNDRED, so THREE. 100. And 8, okay, R-E-D, and 8, okay, this is question number 3. What is the value of the number 4 in 642? Well, the value for 4 is actually 40, because when I say the number, it's 642. So it's 6100, okay, 4 tens, which is 40, and 2 units. So the number is 40. This is question number 4. What is the value of the number 9 in 91,486? Well, the value is 90,000. So it's 9 and then 4 zeros. Okay, so it's 90,000. This is question number 5. Calculate 670 divided by 100. So when I divide by 100, it's moving the decimal point 2 places to the left. So one place will be 67, and then I do it again. So the answer is going to be 6.7. Okay, so dividing it by 10, I get 67. Dividing it by 10 again, I get 6.7. This is question number 6. Calculate 2.73 times 10. Well, moving the decimal place 1 point to the right, I get 27.3. Okay. Right, we are now going to be looking at bid mass. Calculate 2 plus 3 times 5 minus 4. So I'm going to do 3 times 5 first. So 3 times 5 is 15. 2, add 15, subtract 4. So 2 add 15 is 17. 17 minus 4 is 13. Okay, so it should be a number 2 there, guys, just to be clear. Okay. This is question number 2. Paula says that 2 times 3 minus 2 times 5 equals minus 4. Steve says the answer is 10. Who is right and why? So again, using bid mass. So doing the timesing first, okay, because it's bracket, then indices, which is index or power, then division, then multiplication, then addition, then subtraction. So it's always division and then timesing. Okay, afterwards, so 2 times 3 is 6, and then stick that minus sign there. 2 times 5 is 10, 6 subtract 10 is negative 4. So Paula is correct. So Paula is correct because using bid mass to work it out, I did 2 times 3 first, and then I did 2 times 5, and then I took this number away from this number, so I took 10 away from 6. This is question number 3. 10 take away 3 to the power of 2. Well, 3 to the power of 2 means 3 squared. So 3 squared means 3 times 3, which is 9. 10 take away 9 is equal to 1. This is question number 4. 15 minus 3 times 2 all squared. Well, doing the bit inside the bracket first. So 15 minus 6, okay? So I did 2 times 3 first, and then I subtracted away from 15, and then I square my answer. 15 take away 6 is equal to 9. 9 squared, or 9 to the power of 2, means 9 times 9, which is equal to 81. Okay, so whenever you see these sums, always remember bid mass, okay? So brackets, indices, division, multiplication, addition, and subtraction. In some textbooks here, it might be written as bod mass, where the word O represents other. Okay, so other would be like index here, or anything else, okay, that isn't a order of operation. Okay, but it's always following that rule when I have a sum involving more than one operation. Okay, now we're looking at types of numbers. Okay, this is question number 1. List the first 5 multiples of 8. Well, the word multiples just means times tables. So 8 times tables. So 8, 16, 24, 32, and 40. Okay, so 8, 16, 24, 32, 40. This is question number 2. List the first 5 multiples of 14. So I'm going to have 14. Then adding 14, I get 28. Then I get 42. Then I get 56, and then I get 70, okay? So if you're unsure, then it's just adding 14 each time. So the word multiple just means times tables, okay? This is question number 3. List all the factors of 32. So factors are numbers that go into 32. Okay, so whole numbers that multiply to give me 32. So 1 and 32, because 1 times 32 is 32. Okay, 2 and 16 is another one, a factor pair. 4 and 8, okay, because 4 times 8 is 16, and I don't think there are any other factors. So the factors are 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and 32. So they are all the numbers that go into the number 32 and doesn't give me a remainder as an answer. So it's a number that goes into it wholly. Okay, so a whole number. This is question number 4. List all the factors of 48. Well, again, so factors means numbers that go into it. 48 is an even number, so 2 is going to go into it, and 24. Okay, 2 and 24. Okay, always start with obviously 1 and 48. So 1 and 48. 2 and 24. 3 and 16 are also another factor pair. Okay. I'll just put like a comma here. So yeah, just being clear. So it is a list of numbers, okay? And 4 and 12. And also 6 and 8. Okay. So comma there. Okay, 6 and 8. Okay, so the factors of 48 are as follows. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 12, 16, 24, and 48. So they are all the numbers that go into 48. So it's just to be clear, guys, and be careful. So it's not the 48 times tables, it's numbers that multiply together to give me the answer of 48. Okay, so it's always best to start off with 1 and that number itself, and then seeing its other factors by looking at the times tables of smaller numbers. Okay, so it requires you to not know your times tables for that, okay, but they are both even numbers, okay, so I can divide them both by 2, and then from there I can start splitting it into essentially some sort of factor tree that will tell me like other numbers that multiply. This is question number 5. What is the 6th prime number? Well, a prime number has only 2 factors, one in itself. So the first one is 2, then it's 3, then it's 5, then it's 7, then it's 11, and then it's 13. So the 6th prime number is equal to 13. So let's just put a little circle around that so we know. So the 6th prime number, is equal to 16. Okay, this is question number 6. Explain why 20 is not a square number. So a square number just means a number that I multiply by itself. I raise it to the power of 2 and I get that number. Okay, so square number. So square numbers are 1 to the power of 2. So 1 squared means 1 times 1. 1 squared is 1. So 1 is actually a square number. 2 squared is 2 times 2, which is 4. Okay. 3 squared is 3 times 3, which is 9. Okay, so 3 to the power of 2 is 3 times 3. Okay. 4 squared is equal to 16. And 5 squared is equal to 5 times 5, which is 25. Okay. So it's equal to 25. Now, the numbers next to the equal sign, so on the right hand side of the equal sign, these are all my square numbers. So 1, 4, 9, 16, 25 are square numbers. Now 20 lies in between 16 and 25, so there is not a whole number, so there is not an integer that I multiply by itself by to give me 20, okay? Because if I try and take the square root of 20, it doesn't give me a whole number answer. So the square root of 16 gives me 4. The square root of 25 gives me 5. But 20 lies in between that. So 20 will be like 4 point something. But it doesn't give me a whole number, an integer answer. Okay. So now we're going to look at the direct numbers, actually. Okay, so, yeah. This section. So this is question number 1. Put these numbers in ascending order. Okay, so ascending order means smallest to biggest. Okay, ascending means start the smallest to the biggest. So the smallest is negative 7. Remember that the bigger the negative, the smaller the number, if that makes sense. Negative 5, negative 3, and then 1 and 3. Okay, so that's going from smallest to biggest. Okay, this is question number 2. Okay, put these numbers in ascending order. Okay, so again, start from the smallest to biggest. the smallest number is going to be negative 8. Then it's negative 7, so there should be a comma there. Then it's negative 3. Then it's 4. And then it's 9. Okay. So these are what are called commas. Okay, so negative 8, negative 7, negative 3, 4 and 9. This is question number 3. 5 take away 11. Well, I start at 5 and I take away 11, I get negative 6. Question 3, so the answer is negative 6. Question 4. Okay, let's write that in a careful way. So the answer to question 3 is negative 6. For question 4, I've got negative 6 plus negative 3. Well, the plus and minus goes to a minus. So I have negative 6 take away 3, which is negative 9. This is question number 5. Minus 2 times minus 3. Now a negative times a negative gives me a positive. So 2 times 3, is just positive 6. Okay, so I'm just going to put a 6 there rather than put a plus sign. So the answer is just 6. Okay, sorry about my handwriting today, guys. I hope you are able to read it still. Okay, in spite of it not being very clear. This is question number 6. Negative 6 times negative 7 is positive 42. 5 times negative 6. Well, a positive times a negative is a negative, so I get minus 30. 36 divided by minus 9 is minus 4. Minus 2 minus 4 is minus 6. And 18 minus 32 is equal to negative 14, guys. Okay. Right, guys, we will now look at indices. Okay. So, simplify the following. Y to the power of 7 times y to the power of 3. Now, when I have the same base and I multiply, I just add the powers. So, 7 plus 3 is 10. So the answer is y to the power of 10. For question number 2, a squared times a to the 5 times a cubed. Well, if I just add my powers together, 2 plus 5 plus 3, I get 10, okay? Because 2 plus 3 is 7, and 7 plus 3 is equal to 10. Okay, this is question number 3. B to the power of 7 divided by b to the power of 6. Well, I'm going to subtract the powers when I'm dividing, provided that I've got the same base, so it only works with the same base. 7 take away 6 is just 1, okay, so it's b to the power of 1, or just b. Okay, this is question number 4, h to the power of 3 divided by h to the power of 8, so it's h to the power of 3 take away 8, which is h to the negative 5, or I can write it as 1 over h to the 5, either is correct. Okay, this is question number 5. Let's work out the numerator first. So, timesing, I'm going to add the powers on the top. 2 plus 3 gives me 5, so it's c to the power of 5 divided by c to the power of 4. And I'm going to subtract the powers, so I just get c to the power of 5 take away 4, which is 1. Okay, so it's just going to be equal to C. Okay, this is question number 6. G to the power of 0. Now, this is a special case. Anything to the power of 0 in maths is always 1. Okay, anything to the power of 0 is always equal to 1. This is question number 7. K to the 4 divided by K times K cubed. But let's work out the denominator first. of my fraction. So k times k cubed. Well, I've got an invisible 1 here. So I'm going to have 1 plus 3 on the bottom, which is 4. K to the power of 4 divided by k to the power of 4. Well, anything divided by itself is just going to give me 1, but it's k to the power of 4, take away 4, which is 0, and anything to the power of 0 is always equal to 1. So there is like a little proof of why power of 0 always equals 1. A power of 0 equals 1 because you are dividing that letter or number by itself. Anything divided by itself will always give me 1. And using the division rules of indices, when you subtract the powers, it will give you power of 0, which gives you 1. Okay, right, this section now, rounding and estimating. Round 34 to nearest 10. So looking at my units column, that's going to go to 30. Round 4,932 to nearest 100, we're looking at my, so it's my 100 kilometers, so looking here, so it's going to be 4,900 to nearest 100, okay, so looking at that 3 there, so it's always looking at the units to the right from what I'm rounding to, if that makes sense. Round 4.2 to nearest whole number, that's going to equal 4. This is question number 4, round 32.685 to one decimal place. Well, that 8 there is going to bump that up, so it's 32.7. Oops. Okay, this is question number 5, round 62,359 to one significant figure. We're looking at this 2 here, so 6 is my first SF, okay, 2 is my second SF, so SF is just short for 6 significant figures, okay, so the 2 rounds it down, so it's going to be just 60,000, okay, this is question number 6, round this decimal to 2 significant figures. We're looking at the third one, it's a 4, so the answer is 0.070, okay? So, the idea of SF is that it's the first non-zero number, and then the rest are zeros afterwards when you round, if that makes sense, okay? This is question number 7. Estimate this. Now, whenever you see the word estimate, it's always rounding it to one significant figure. So, 72 goes to 70, 362 goes to 400, and 0.49 goes to 0.5. Okay. So on the top, 7 times 4 is 28, and the zeros, I'm going to get 28,000. So 28,000 divided by 0.5. Now, dividing by 0.5 is something special. It actually doubles my answer, because if you think halves into 1, it goes twice. So it's going to double my answer. So it's going to be 56,000. Okay. That's my answer for question number 7. Okay, so the word estimate, it doesn't mean work out. It's round each number to one significant figure. Okay, right guys, it's the last section now. HCF and LCM. HCF stands for highest common factor and lowest common multiple. So, question number 1. Calculate the highest common factor of 32 and 48. So it's the highest number that goes into both 32 and 48. So what we're going to do here is decompose it. So we're going to do prime composition. Okay, and see what number. Now some of it is a bit easier because it is both like even numbers. So I know that my answer is actually going to have to be 16, okay? So again, actually, yeah, it's a bit about trial and error. So 16 is the highest number that goes into both of these numbers, if that makes sense. Because 16 times 2 is 32, and 16 times 3 is 48. 16 is the highest number that goes into both of those numbers, if that makes sense. But if you're not sure where that number's come from, then it's doing it by prime factor decomposition. So it's writing it as a product of prime numbers. So 32 is 8 and 4. 48 is 8 and 6. Okay. And then I can split that into 2 and 3. Okay. And then I can... Oops. 2 and 2, sorry. And that's going to be 2 and 3. Okay. And you can see, I don't have to, like, go any further because 8 is common in both. And 2 is common in both. Okay. So, 8 times 2 gives me that 16, okay, so that's where it's come from. It's come from this factor tree here. So 8 and 2 are common in both factor trees. Okay, I haven't, like, simplified it fully, but the idea is looking for common numbers that are in both trees, if that makes sense. Okay, so let's rub this out now so we've got a bit more space. Okay. This is question number 2. Calculate the lowest common multiple of 6 and 14. So this time it's the smallest number that's in both times tables. Now this is a bit more tricky because it's not as simple. One way of doing it is looking at the times table. So we will look at the times tables and see what number we reach. So 14, 28... 42. Okay, I'm going to stop there actually because I know that 6 times 7 is 42. So the lowest common multiple of these two numbers is 42. It's the smallest number that appears in both times tables. So whenever it's looking at LCM, lowest common multiple, it's looking at the times tables of the two numbers. Now, sometimes it's a bit more tricky because it's not always as straightforward, depending on what numbers you're actually given. But this is the best way that I prefer to work out. So look at the times tables of each numbers. Once you reach that number, okay, now I knew that I could stop here because I knew that 42 was divisible by 6 because 42 is 6 times 7. So I knew that, so I could actually stop there. But if you're not happy with your times tables, then just write it out until you reach 36 and then 42. And then there would be your answer. So 42 appears there. And it appears there. So whenever you see the word lowest common multiple, it's the smallest number that appears in both times tables. Okay. So hopefully it makes sense. Okay. Okay, so last few questions for today's video. So lowest common multiple of 12 and 15. Okay, so it's a bit more trickier. Now, I've actually got an answer in my head, actually, because obviously I'm working it out, obviously, in my head. So, times tables. So, 15, 30, 45, and 60. Now, I'm going to stop at 60 because I know that 60 is 5 lots of 12. So, my answer is going to be 60, and I can check my answer. 12, 24, 36... 48 and 60. Okay, so what I do is I go up in each subdivision until I reach a number that is common in both. Once it's common in both, then I stop there. So 60 appears in both. Therefore, 60 is the lowest common multiple of those two numbers. Okay. Right, last one for today's video, guys. Calculate the highest common factor of 72 and 60. Okay, so it's the highest number that goes into both numbers. Now, it's both even, so I know that it's going to have to be 8 even number, most likely, but it might look like another number, if that makes sense. So let's try and decompose these numbers. So 60 and 72. Now, the number that comes to mind actually, is actually 4. Okay, because 4, I think, goes into both. But I don't know if it goes any further. Okay. So I think the answer should be 12, actually, now that I've actually worked it out. Because 12 times 5 is 60, and 12 times... So let's just check here. So that'll be 12 and 5. That'll be 12 and 6. Now, there are no common numbers between 5 and 6. So 12 is the highest number, okay? That goes into both numbers. 12 times 5 is 60, and 12 times 6 is 72. Okay, but for highest common factor, the idea is it's called prime decomposition. So it's decomposing it into its prime factors. Now, I didn't do that completely because, it's looking around actually and finding tricks and ways to actually work out your answer. So, my logic here was a bit of like trial and error here, so seeing what numbers went into it. I thought of 4 first, but then I thought, wait a second, another number, obviously could also be 6, okay? And then I realised, well, 6 actually isn't actually the highest one, actually, because it can be 12, okay? So it's just actually testing, it is testing, like, make sure that you know your factors of those numbers. And if you don't, then it's obviously worth practicing, like, your times tables. And also how to work out factors of, like, different numbers. Okay. But right, guys, so that is the end of today's tutorial. Okay, I hope you found it useful. If you did, please press like. Please subscribe to the channel if you're new. Okay, and lastly, please turn on post notification by clicking that bell icon so you don't miss out on further videos and further help with your maths for Key Stage 3, GCSE and A-Level Pure Maths and A-Level Further Pure Maths. Okay, but that's it for me today, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Take care, stay safe, and I'll catch you the next one. Okay, bye for now.